Exiled members of the Syrian president's family have been meeting with global leaders seeking a peaceful end to Bashar al-Assad's rule. But the involvement of this estranged arm of the al-Assad family is angering many Syrians. We're going to hear from Bashar al-Assad's exiled cousin in a moment. First, here's why some consider the family's participation in any solution intolerable.
Rare images of the aftermath of the 1982 assaults on the Syrian city of Hama. It was the response of then-President Hafez al-Assad to an Islamic rebellion led by the Muslim Brotherhood against his regime. There are conflicting reports on how many people were killed in the conflict. Amnesty International puts the number at between 10 and 25,000, while a recently declassified US intelligence report says the total casualties probably number about 2,000. The late Syrian president's brother, Military General Rifat al-Assad, has long been suspected of spearheading the 1982 assault and is called the Butcher of Hama by many. Rifat has denied any involvement in the crackdown, accusing the regime of, quote, misinformation following a power struggle with his brother, which led him into exile in 1984. From abroad, he resumed his push for the presidency in the late 1990s in opposition to current president Bashar al-Assad, the son of his brother. Rifat remains opposed to his nephew and continues to live with his family in exile in Europe. Having recently sold a mansion in Paris for almost 90 million, it's a life far removed from the current struggles in Syria, where he claims he has strong support. There also remains bitter opposition to the now 75-year-old, who many still believe to be a war criminal.
Well, Rifat's son, Ribal, has been in Washington and in London denouncing Bashar al-Assad and the jihadists involved in the Syrian insurgency. I spoke to Ribal a few weeks ago and began by asking about the message that he's been delivering to world leaders. Have a listen to this.
It's very important for them to know that we should not be arming the rebels, because first of all, we should know who are we going to be arming. And I think most of these rebels and most of the rebel-held areas are under Islamist control, and the Supreme Military Council of the Free Syrian Army is made up of Salafi groups such as Sukur al-Sham, Al-Tawhid Brigade, the Syrian Marches Brigade, Dar al-Sawra. So it is very dangerous. I think we should be all working with the international community, the United States, everyone on board, try to seek a peaceful solution to the Syrian conflict.
I'm wondering what your qualifications are at this point for getting involved in any plans for Syria's future. You are a Syrian, of course, but you are from a highly discredited family. Your father was a government enforcer before his exile. He's widely blamed as the architect of the Hama massacre in 1982. I've spoken to a lot of Syrians here as part of the diaspora in the UK, and they say, why would you listen to Ribal? So tell me, why should we?
I mean, my message, Becky, as you know, I've exiled, and I feel for all people who have been exiled and who have suffered from this regime. I have personally suffered from this regime. My father left in 1984 because he disagreed with that regime in, back in Damascus, and because he wanted to move towards democracy in Syria. And this is what we are seeing
going on today. Despite the fact that he was an enforcer of what was an absolute situation of carnage in Hama.
No, this is what people... Sorry, Becky, though, this is what people say, but this is not the truth. There was a Defense Intelligence Agency report that was declassified lately who said exactly that, what exactly went on in Hama, and it's it shows the realities of what went on. Anyway, I'm not here today to talk about the history of my father. I'm here today because it is very essential that we bring, that the United States and the international community, Britain, France, should work on a peaceful solution. They should work on bringing all the opposition, the democratic, genuine opposition who believe in our values, the universal values of human rights, the women's right, the equalities of all people under the rule of law, regardless of sex, religion, ethnic group. It's very important. And the Syrian people, the peaceful majority of the Syrian people, they have to see that there is a viable alternative to the regime.
You've said that you've got no aspirations to power in Syria, correct?
Yes, that's very correct.
And your father?
Of course not. He said it also openly that he doesn't have any aspiration for power in Syria.
I remember when your father left Syria,
and at the time at least, and since then, he has believed and voiced the fact that he believes that he still has support. I left Syria, he said, with 85% of the Syrian people supporting me and its military. What if he decided that he did want to lead going forward? Would you encourage him?
I know very well that my father has a lot of supporters in Syria. That we know for facts. We know from contacts with officers, with people in the Ba'ath Party, with people in the military. We know very well that the support that he has. But it's not the matter today. He has said it openly. He has said it that I do not want to be part of any government. He could, of course, play a role in, you know, a transition role. Him and many other people should play that role in Syria that have influence, actually. It's very important. We need that.